DNA is very useful for identifying people, both living and deceased. But have you ever wondered, can you find out specific information about your matches just based on the DNA that you share with them? Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor stories along the way. Today, we're going to be looking at how you can use your match data to infer what certain traits are about other people. Now, this can be really useful if you have done things like visual phasing, where you've mapped out different ancestors, or just with chromosome painting, you've mapped out certain DNA segments that come from various ancestors. You might be able to deduce certain traits about those ancestors just from that DNA. The first step is that we need to find the specific location of a trait. Now, it's important to recognize that most traits and medical conditions are not dependent on a single gene in our chromosomes. There's actually a lot of genes that interact to form those traits. However, there are some traits that are defined by a single gene. For instance, we're going to use the blood group gene ABO today, in order to see if we can find other matches that might have the same blood type as us. In order to find what gene a specific trait is on, I like to go to SNPpedia. Now, SNPpedia has information basically about all the SNPs that have been found. And in this case, searching can be really simple. We can go up to the search box and type in ABO, ABO, and that's going to be the blood group SNPs. Now, there might be several of those, but there's going to be some more information on the website. As we read down about ABO, we actually see, hey, there is this SNP, RS8176719, that is what determines the change from blood type A to blood type O. It's basically a single SNP that if it has been deleted, you are going to have O on that gene as opposed to A. So finding out whether or not the company is tested with that, you're going to have to search through the raw data. 23andMe makes that easy for you. I can just put that SNP in and it's going to look and tell me, hey, this is on chromosome number 9 and here is your SNP information. It says it can have either a deletion or a letter C. And in my case, I have a deletion on one of my chromosomes and a C on the other chromosome, which means I have blood type A because I have an A and an O. So knowing this, if there are any matches that match me at this specific location, fully matched, then they also have that AO. Now, depending on your blood type, you might have AA, in which case if you have somebody that's just a half match, then they're going to have blood type A with you, maybe AB. But they're not going to be a type O because you have to have two O's. I know what the SNP is. I know what chromosome it's on. I know it is at 136 million. Now, this is where it's important to take a look at things. If we go back over to SNPpedia and we scroll down, we can see that the gene SNP here has a location of 133 million for this SNP, whereas 23andMe says 136 million. Well, what's happening is 23andMe is reporting this in build 37, and if we go to SNPpedia, that SNP is actually under build 38. So we want to use the 136 million as the place where this SNP is located. We found the location of our trait. We want to go on now to step number 2, which is to use the segment search tool in GEDmatch. Now, this is a tier 1 tool, but it will allow us to find all of the matches that match us in this general area. So on the segment search tool, I'm going to enter in my kit number. And it's going to ask me what's the maximum number of kits. I'm just going to leave it at 1,000. This is where you might want to actually change the snip count or the minimum size. I'm going to change the size down to 3 centimorgans as opposed to just 7 centimorgans. And I don't want to look at all of the chromosomes. I only want to look on chromosome number 9. Next, I'm going to put in that location, and I want to actually be very narrow because I know that it is at 136,200,000 or something. So I'm going to put in 135,000,000 and 137,000,000. And again, this is because I'm using build number 37. If I was using build number 38, then I would want to do the 133 to 134, 132 to 134. So I have a very narrow range, which means it's only going to look for matches that cross over this narrow range. Now it's going to calculate for a minute or so to find all those matches that match that segment. Here is the match list. Now again, these people all match in that segment. It doesn't mean that they match across the entire segment, just that some part of the segment that I defined, they match in. So as I'm going down and looking at this, these first few people are actually very closely related to me. They're kids that I have. I go further down, this ends at 135 million. I don't want those. Here's one at 141 million. Here's some more at 135 million. And as I go down and look, there's actually a couple of promising kids here. Here is one at 133 to 137. Here's another one from 135 to 137. So it's just a very narrow band. And I think that's the one I'm going to take a look at. We've finished the segment search and we found a list of people that we want to compare ourselves to. Now we're going to use the one-to-one comparison. The key with the one-to-one comparison is we want to actually use the full resolution so we can see specifically at that location whether they're just a half match or whether they're potentially a full match with us. On our one-to-one, we put in the two kits. We want to take a look at the graphics and positions, but we only want to display the chromosomes that we match segments with. So we don't have all 22 chromosomes. We're probably just going to have one or maybe two chromosomes. Next is the most important thing, and that is to click on the full resolution so that you can actually narrow in on that segment and see whether or not you are a half match or a full match in that position. And then finally, we want to eliminate hard breaks. Then we click on submit. I've zoomed in on chromosome number 9, and we want position 136 million. So this is going to start at the caret right here. We count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 136 million starts at this point right here. Now, what is the exact position that we're looking for? If we go back to the 23andMe raw data, it says 136,132,000. So this is 136 million. This is 137 million. So 100 and halfway is about right here. That would be 136.5 million. And right about here would be 136,250,000. And somewhere right in here would be 136,136,000. And it's right where I want to be looking. Now, because of the amount of yellows and where they might show up, it's not definitive. Sometimes when you're looking at these single traits, you'll actually have a big section of green that really overlaps the area that you want. In this case, it might be in this big section of green, in which case this person is the same blood type and they actually are an AO. So they are a type A blood, but they have an O gene and an A gene, just like me. On the other hand, if it ends up hitting in one of these, this yellow part right here, they might still be an A, but they might be an AA, or they might be an O blood type and be OO. So you may be thinking, hey, that's actually pretty difficult to try to narrow down that. And yeah, it is. You don't have access to the other person's raw data, so you can't pinpoint exactly where it's at. You have to use some graphics and make some assumptions. So in this case, I'm just going to assume that it's in this green and that this person has the same blood type as me. They have type A blood. Again, you can try this with those traits that are defined by a single gene, by finding out where along the genome it is and comparing yourself to them. As more and more people do things like visual phasing and we start reconstructing some of the genomes of people that have already been deceased, I think this is a great technology to be able to start to infer what those characteristics that they may have had, even if you don't have access to that raw data. If you want to learn more about the ABO blood type and how you can find it on your genes, then why don't you watch this video up here? And if you have any questions about GEDmatch, I have this playlist of how to use several different tools from GEDmatch.